Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome back after this post-lunch session. I'm sure the session with Akash is really going to have you very engrossed, and despite it being a post-lunch session, I'm sure you'll be totally involved in this session. So I'd like to welcome Akash Surekha. Akash comes with a strong mobility and IT background with about 15 years of varied experience in global product companies, having worked on delivering global products for marquee companies like Nvidia, Milcare, Nokia, and Motorola. Before venturing out to start up a global product company around auto content discovery and technology, he spent a lot of time delivering consumer and business solutions to companies like Samsung, HTC, Toshiba, Sharp, Qualcomm, Intel, and Microsoft, to name a few. He's won quite a few awards, and I will now request him to take over. Akash.
So formally, good afternoon to everyone. As she said, I'll try my best to keep you engrossed in the presentation, but I think the nature of the topic itself is so unique, I'm sure that will help us to, you know, be engaged, your side and my side, both sides, right? As she have already given a quick background, I've been a serial entrepreneur myself, founded a company, sold to Persistent Systems, where I work and head their global mobility division now. And I'm a passionate believer about artificial intelligence. You know, everyone has said, but you know, I also believe that it's the next wave of internet. So it's very important to see, you know, what lies ahead in terms of artificial intelligence, robotics, and so on. What are the opportunities? And if you, I was just reading one tweet from Dev Kare, is a venture capitalist, and he was, you know, in Bangalore, and he was saying, you know, everywhere people are doing bots. So, you know, should we put a name to Bangalore? And he was like, you know, bot lore, or you know, some names were coming out. So I said, that's exactly what I'm talk about in Pune. So what is the next name for Pune? So like Botone may be the new name for Pune. So the whole idea is to, you know, drive that excitement on artificial intelligence and robotics and see what are the opportunities lying ahead, right? Now, before I really start, I want everyone to tweet to make Pune as one of the central point for artificial intelligence, right? So we have some of this handles and hashtags, including hash Pune, you know, which I would like you guys to use your tweets and write about it to spread that awareness about artificial intelligence, right? Now, before I really start, I really want to put up one video. How many of you know Boston Dynamics as a company or as an organization? One? Oh, pretty cool. So I'm sure you guys are following Boston Dynamics. For others who don't know, I'll just give a quick glimpse what's happening over there. This is a robot which has been developed by Boston Dynamics. It's part of Google Group. And this is what they're showing, his intelligence to walk outside on his own with all the barriers, what he's seeing on ground, on his front, on his left, on his right, and how does it come back successfully. So if you see how he's driving himself with the barriers which are coming in front of him. And also at the same point of time, how he's able to balance himself or itself, you know, on that particular snow, thick snow which is there. And this is one of the employees of Boston Dynamics, and you know, this is something very unique in nature. It's a small warehouse, and he's been given the task to put up all the boxes and shipping items in the racks for next shipment. So he puts away the box from him. Then That guy is really trying hard that he does not pick up the box. Then he gets, as usual, whatever, you know. So he tried his last option to hit him out. He stands up. Moves out of the office. He knows how to open the door as well, by the way. How was it? Any initial reactions on that? Yeah. Can you switch the mic, please? Oh, yeah. On? Yeah, okay, thanks. So, well, somebody said cute, somebody said amazing. But is there anybody who is getting scared because of this? I've got two hands. Or three, four. That's it? That's it? Okay, so maybe a quick word. Why are you scared?
I don't know what we are creating. And since it's reacting to our reactions, as we have seen in Hollywood, they become stronger and stronger and stronger. And we don't know whether we'll be able to control our creation.
Okay.
That's my scare.
Prakash, any thought from you?
Yeah, recently there was this game.
Go game. Yeah.
And that was really scary. It's an intelligence that gets built and then it picks it and then it knows the algorithm and it recalibrates. I think the processing power can really be tremendous, much more than what humans can do. So as you said, you know, we don't know where we are heading towards. I mean, this is really a scary innovation.
Sure. Anybody else? Does anybody feel scared from taking out jobs? You know, making humans more lazier, making humans more violent, making humans, you know, do few things which they're not supposed to do. Right?
This is straight leading to social problems, especially okay. This lifting of boxes is a typical Indian job. I mean, if that job also is gone.
Yeah.
So it's really scary. I mean, it's going to lead to a social issue problem.
Sure. Anybody from logistics companies here? Okay. Any thoughts, sir, from your side? You're happy? But are your employees going to be happy?
They would do better jobs than what they're doing now.
Where else? Thank you. A good round of applause for him. So he's not scared. That's a good thing to know. Anybody else want to share one last thought?
So probably people will start looking at agriculture again. Because okay. Most people are migrating from agriculture to, you know, professional world as they're getting educated.
Sure.
That is one. So educated class anyway is trying to get back into agriculture sector.
So we'll see more innovations in agriculture.
Agriculture.
People concentrating on innovating in agriculture. Okay. So if you see, we've got this mixed response. Some people are scared. Some people, you know, think it's good for us. Coming from horse's mouth, he thinks that is right for his company as a logistics company or a warehouse management company, right? But having said that, something like this can wipe off 5,000 jobs of Amazon warehouse, 2,000 jobs of Flipkart warehouse, DHL warehouse, right? So there are pros and cons. Now it's with us to decide what we want to do with them, how do we want to build it, and how do we essentially put humans as the first thought process while creating that, right? So as long as we can think human while creating robots or anything which is powered by artificial intelligence, is going to drive the future. And that's what we call as AI is the next wave of internet. It's the next wave of future. You don't know what's going to happen, right? So what we're going to do today is, fairly, I'm not going to make it very geeky in nature, right? That's not the intent. So we're going to talk about what technologies are involved in AI, how matured those technologies are, which kind of companies are working in AI space, then what are applications of AI in various segments, industries, and verticals, and then come back again and see how do we differ between humans and robots, and what do we think. And then at the end, we're going to do one small, very small workshop as what do we think, what can be innovated in various verticals using AI, right? So is that a fair agenda, right? Okay, Thanks. So moving on to the next slide, let's first understand what is intelligence. Right? We are all humans. We are all intelligent one or other way. So it's essential to understand how AI has evolved and why it is called artificial intelligence. Right? So again, coming back to you guys, if somebody can say, what is intelligence? What is human intelligence? What drives human intelligence? Anybody? Very simple. All, you are all intelligent. Reasoning? Okay. React? Reactiveness? Okay. Decision making? Part of reactiveness? Be aware so that you can act? Okay. Comprehend? Okay. Be assertive? So model, understand, reason out, and then react. Anything else? Learn and adapt. Ability to think. Sure. Innovate. Okay, it's part of reaction. Language. This. Do we think that language is also part of intelligence? Right? How many of you think language is the most important part of intelligence? That's it? So if you, okay, so you think it's right. But people who have not raised hands, do you think that if there's no language, intelligence can still be there? If you don't understand what the person is saying, you'll not be able to react. I mean, before you'll not be able to think, you'll not be able to model, you'll not be able to adopt, right? So language is where it starts, in a way. Communication, where it starts, in a way. But if you read something, it's kind of a language, and you understand, you get educated, that's part of language. If you don't know language, you'll not be able to read as well. Okay, so that's a different issue. We'll not go into that. Okay. Yeah, so I think most of you are bang on. Absolutely. Absolutely. Point taken. Big applause for him. So, yeah, I mean, essentially, intelligence is not directly proportionate to how well you know language. Yeah, so language is one part of intelligence. I agree. But yes, most of you guys are bang on. Some of the critical points which forms human intelligence, which helps compare or map to artificial intelligence, are a few things what you have said. Learning, you know, you learn, you model, you reason out, right, so that you can react accordingly. You perceive things, so that allows you to think out of the box and also in the same domain. Language forms an important part to understand, to read, so that it allows you to break that language in different things, understand different topics, and then act on that as well, right? And most important thing is feeling, right? I mean, that's what forms human intelligence as part of humans, right? Now let's go to artificial intelligence, right? So can anybody now map this to AI, which is, I mean, it's very pretty straightforward, right? You just replace human with artificial, rest all remain same. But what all additional components now may get in because it just called artificial? Anybody? One could be very obvious.
There has to be a separation between ability to make a decision and execute that decision. Intelligence, AI, ability to perceive things better, making faster.
Faster and quicker and better decisions.
Get to a decision. But whether that decision should be executed or not, that's a moral issue also.
Okay.
It is not just an issue of reacting.
So, sure.
That's what I was trying to point out in the earlier video also. The robot is able to execute whatever decision it is able to take.
Sure.
There is no barrier in there.
Sure.
There has to be a human who controls the execution part of the decision making.
Absolutely. So that's where, as I said, while designing robots, you have to think human first, which allows you to control and execute that kind of thing from a human perspective, right? Yeah, but you know, just getting back on this particular part, is what are the components which you think which will now get additionally in AI on top of human intelligence parameters we discussed in last slide, right? So obviously it's not human, so it's non-human now. So there are few components which are supposed to come in, which will form part of artificial intelligence. So can somebody think, what are components? I mean, one thing is very obvious. Feedback, instructions, software instructions, machine level instructions, okay. Machine learning. Okay, infrastructure, computers, can I say, right? Sensors, okay. Data management, sure. So data management and intelligence is an additional component which comes in, right? Yeah. So cloud, data, sensors, computers, data intelligence, big data. Okay, anything else? Anybody? Algorithms, part of machine learning, okay, yeah. Design, okay. There's one cool startup I just met who does robotic design. Can you raise your hand? Is he here? He left? Okay, I think he left. Okay, okay. So, sorry? Come back again. Imaging, yeah, image processing. So I'll just put it in the bracket of camera or, you know, sensors. It's kind of a sensor which allows to process images or any other kind of data, right? But yeah. Speech, text to speech, voice recognition, right? Cool. So I think you guys are making my job much more easier. So these are a few essential components which forms as part of artificial intelligence, right? So if you see computer science, I mean, we have been all using computers from ages now. What it does essentially is execute the instructions what you give to that particular object, right? Algorithms, we've been using algorithms across various industries, across various softwares, and so on, right? So that forms essential part how intelligent that robot or that particular piece of object powered by AI could be. Prediction, act, and learn. So this is one of the important parts. So if you see that video, right? So what I want to do is you map these parameters with that video. And essentially, you see prediction forms an important part, right? So it could predict what it is coming in front of it. And hence, it could walk past that barrier and go ahead, right? It could predict somebody is trying to beat that box. So it stands, box falls down, and then picks up, right? So prediction forms a very important part. They react like humans, right? So if you see that robot, he was a very nice guy. He didn't get violent as humans, but when he act as humans, right? So he didn't go and do something unnatural. He did what a human would have do, you know, if that particular guy was his boss, right? Even if he's hitting, he's going and picking up the box and putting up in the rack, right? And then he left out of the office. Sorry, can we have a mic here so that everyone can listen?
AI could lead also, you know, learning those symptoms of being violent. So it does not restrict you, probably.
Sure. So
unless you look at iRobots where, you know,
yeah,
you have three specific instructions.
So it actually again depends who is programming that robot that way.
Correct.
You know, and that's where again that human touch point comes around, yeah, while doing that. But yes, you cannot restrict and you don't know how violent it can go, right? Yeah. Machine learning, you know, it allows you to do complex analysis of various data you collect, breaks down into different components, run analysis on those components, and try to come out with specific set of objectives and results on top of that. So really natural language processing. So when you have English coming out, if I am saying, hey, let's go out for a pizza, right? Now it has mix and match of nouns, it has verbs, it may have adjectives and so on, right? So while you So when a robot wants to understand a language, he has to understand all this grammar in his own way, right? Cut out or bring out the components which it wants and understand and then react, right? So that's what is natural language processing. So I'm not, again, I said I'm not going to go geeky. How does it relate? But how does it translate for a layman to understand, right? So that's what is natural or NLP, what we call as. And the various softwares around all of that, which we're going to talk in later slides. So this is essentially what forms AI. But how many of you believe that AI is just a new age thing? I mean, obviously it says 30 years now, but I might be wrong. How many of you think that AI is just a recent thing? It's just been talked about maybe last 2 years or maybe 5 years, or maybe 10 years. Anybody think that this has been from the ages of where the computers were born? Okay, so there is one lady who thinks about that. Maybe even before that, or just when our Steven Spielberg started making out movies like Minority Reports and so on. Yes, sure, right. Yeah, but it, in that terms, it was called as still a computer science. It was not called as AI. Sure, yeah, but yeah, okay. So thanks for bringing up that point. But anybody else who thinks this is a 50 years old concept? Artificial intelligence, not computer science. As I said, computer science is one form of component of this AI. But artificial intelligence is a holistic solution or a holistic technology. Anybody think there is a 50 years old technology? So let me make it easier. Yes. You know, I put that slide already. So this has been talked about from 30 years, 40 years. He talked about that Turing test, which came up, which overlaps human artificial and computer science and so on, right? So if it's 50 years old, why are we talking so much about AI now? We had computers at that point of time. We have computers at that point of time. We had humans at that particular point of time. We had so many things, right? But why AI now? So this is very obvious. Right.
A lot more ideas looking at different concepts can be now mix matched.
Right.
It would be up in the air, you can do it, but maybe you don't have the tools or the technology.
Right. So maturity of technology and the technology ecosystem, tools, frameworks, softwares, hardwares, talent in terms of engineers, right? Skills, right? Anything apart from these three? So he said talent, skills, ecosystem, maturity of technology. Anything else apart from this three and the fourth one, what we just talked about? Okay, so there we have one. Free trade. Sure, absolutely. Exchange of trade business technologies, which allows everyone to be on same page, making it a level playing field for everybody to innovate, right? And think about AI, okay? Yeah, go ahead, Michael. Sure.
A major conglomerate that needs to build that technology. It's startups like people here that can actually start to innovate and get something to market as opposed to the big multi-billion dollar companies.
Yes. So access to technology and maybe even cost. It's so cheap now to do this kind of things. I mean, earlier it was $1 million to do even a computer, right? So to do something like this would have been a multi-million dollar affair. But now I've seen a Chinese company launching a 7 USD home robot, which does everything what you want your maid to work in a home. Yes, enterprises who are looking to evolve in businesses, and hence lots of business use cases which are available to innovate on that side, right? Yeah. So just quickly wrapping this up, so you have connected world today, right? Cars, somebody's talking clothes, you have shoes, you have phones, you have watch, you have fit bands, hell bands, you have, I don't know, neuro bands, you have smart caps, and so on, right? Proliferation of devices, which has humongous amount of data coming to you or to your trusted party, which collects and can learn, right? So if you start mapping those parameters, what we talked about, right? So computer science was one of the components. So if you see that translates to connected world. So so many computer devices, I mean computer-driven kind of devices across all of you. All of their data coming up to help you predict, to learn, to analyze, to model, all that maps to data intelligence, and then intelligence and automation. So, you know, ability to learn it, ability to learn the language, ability to react, ability to adopt, all is part of intelligence and automation, right? So, and this is happening today. Anybody here who denies that this is not happening today? Anybody here? Okay, great. So I think we are all on the same page till now. So let's move to another slide, is some of the other thing which he rightly described is technology rich business outcome focus. So there's lots of evolution on the business side, which is looking for lesser cost, quick to market, you know, very much outcome focused, objective focused, and so on, right? And then people mindset first. So these are some of the stats with Accenture has mentioned, which says that the data volumes have gone, you know, trillions and trillions. If you see by 2020, there will be more than 44 zettabytes of data. And 35, even more, this is just a prediction. And as you go along, this could even go to 65, 60%. And that will be the data which will be available to analyze, to learn, model, adopt, and react on that. Decreasing cost of storage. So we're just talking about infrastructure, because infrastructure plays a bigger role. For an robot, for an AI, if he has to learn, he needs more and more data, right? He becomes more and more hungry. So data becomes his food. That's his livelihood. So I think that's one of the things which we have to see. As our core food is our livelihood for robots, data is their livelihood, right? And what is driving that is the decreasing storage cost as well. So as we said, the cost of doing these things are very cheaper right now, even from a storage point of view. Unlimited computing power. I think all of us are using public or private cloud in one or other way, right? Facebook, in a way, is a public cloud. All your data which you generate, you talk, you write is stored on Facebook data centers, right? Some of you might be using sales applications that resides on your private cloud and so on. So there is a tremendous computing power which is happening over cloud, which does not make robots to carry, you know, this room, you know, whole room data centers along with him. You don't have to carry all of that. Everything is on cloud. And why that is happening is there's already tremendous growth there. Artificial intelligence technologies. How many of you use iPhones here? Android? Okay, so rest anyways are Android. How many in iPhone users, how many do you use Siri? Cool, doesn't work. Still getting matured. Okay, you have to make him learn or her learn. On Google, how many of you use Google now? Siri much better. Yeah, so we won't go there, absolutely. Yeah, so you won't go there. Everyone likes one or other personal assistant, and we should not debate on who is the good personal assistant, who is bad person. Every personal assistant is good. And then, so there's IT stuff which I'm gonna quickly skip. At the same point of time, businesses are facing number of challenges, right? Let's take our homegrown Flipkart example. Nothing to really put them on spot, but if you see, it's a operational heavy business. All online commerce businesses are operational heavy businesses. So they have logistics, they have warehouses, the shipping, they have cloud, there's so many people, customer service, customer support. And what do they have to do? I think everyone knows. Save money, right, and generate profits and so on. So that's what everyone keeps on talking. But if you see, it's a really complex business, and I think hats off for them to scale that business to that level. But that's one of the business challenge, right? So they have to see how they cut down the operations, they save money on warehouse, they save money on shipping, on logistics, on customer support. Now, this examples alone allows us to think, how can we automate, right? Take an example of customer service. We can automate. If you're putting a simple question, hey, what's your website? You don't need a human to talk and say, this is my website. If somebody is saying, hey, what's your call center number? You don't need a human to give a call center number. And even for basic questions, what's your latest scheme? Well, that's all available as a data. There could be an automated customer service to do that. So now, essentially, if you have 1,000 people customer service support team, with this, you can cut down to what, 5 people? Possibly, yes. So that's a challenge a business is facing. How do I restructure to save cost? I said cost savings, budget pressures everywhere, not only in companies like Flipkart, but every enterprise. A moment a CIO even goes and asks for an extra rack, you know, the CEO just stands up and say, why do you need this? Right? Because those are budgetary pressures what you have on IT side, for example. Right? So there are always budget pressures to increase the top line and to improve your bottom line. Increasing awareness, lots of executives are aware about automation. Right? They are taking more and more roles in businesses as opposed to their siloed role. For example, CIO is no more a pure ID person. He is doing lots of business decisions as well. And hence, because he is more driven from business, he knows what's happening around him. So they are more and more aware on what's happening. And shift of IT spend. So if you see, by 2018, 35% of IT resources will be spent on supporting new creation of digital revenues. It is significant. Right? We talk about hundreds of billions of dollars of IT spends. 35% is significant. And they are not saying that they are going to spend on procuring a network switch or a device or a hardware or a computer or software. So they're talking about creating new digital streams of revenues. How do you do that? Right? So most of these business challenges itself is also driving AI. So that's another thing. Why AI now? And why not earlier? Right? So I think fairly, I'm assuming that you've got what is human intelligence, what is artificial intelligence, how does it map, and what is driving artificial intelligence, right? Any questions you might have on some of the slides what I've gone through before we run into some of the technologies which are driving AI? Any questions? Any silly, random, stupid, or any intelligent question?
Is much cheaper, but at the same time, the availability of cash has increased more to more number of people, which was not earlier. Earlier it was with few, but now it's a lot of people have availability of cash.
Yeah.
And a lot of cash leads to thinking, what do I do with cash?
Yeah.
Where do I invest?
Yeah.
And that's where also certain time AI gets driven. Yes,
correct.
Definitely there has to be a pain point to drive that.
Correct. So access of capital.
Access of
is capital. Also driving, in a way, AI could be one of the things, right? Yes, absolutely.
Although we call this term as intelligence, artificial intelligence, but if you compare it with human intelligence, probably it is not even...
After seeing that robot as well?
Yeah, I mean, that's like a 2-3 year old.
Difference to ek hi reh gaya, usse uthke usko marta tha, isne mara nahi, but baaki to sabhi kiya usne.
No, I think, you know, even like that way, if I compare any electronic man-made thing like camera, can you compare it with the power of what I can do? It's
sure.
Just, you can't compare. That's where I was going. I mean, human can create robots, but can robots create robots?
Yeah, so I'll take that as a comment, that robots are still not so intelligent as human. Point taken. Okay. Any question?
Hi, yeah. Here.
Can you raise your hand? Ah, okay.
Yeah. I think you will be the right person because you must have done extensive study on this subject. I think what essentially the difference between human intelligence and artificial one is maybe the emotional quotient and the reactions and how to take a decision when a spot on decision has to be taken. It's not programmed. You have to have the reactions working. So what's the way forward you are seeing? Because you are very close to this particular subject, what's your take? If right kind of approach is there, you see one particular day human intelligence and artificial intelligence will be coinciding with each other, maybe sooner.
I think, can we take up this at the end of the presentation?
Sure.
Is that okay? Because I think that's the right time.
Yeah, but you have to answer this.
We'll do that. Absolutely.
Yeah. Sure. Thanks.
Okay. Go ahead. No, so emotions are not getting considered in robots, and that's how robots are more logical than humans.
Because the video that you showed, it was pretty much very cold. I mean, the guy doing some job.
As of today. I'm sorry, come back again.
No, the video that you showed in the beginning was just a very cold, emotionless guy.
Logical.
Doing certain things mechanically.
Yes.
But would emotions sometimes be factored in? Because
my
one
comment.
Of the attributes you listed down, emotions was the last one. And so, are they coming here?
They will start coming in as the technologies become more mature. And that's where NLPs will play a very big role, right? How do you learn the language? and bring emotions out of that. So for now, lots of focus is on logical intelligence as opposed to emotional intelligence. Right? Yeah. Yeah, but think about your baby, grown-up kid, wants to have a robotic friend. You might need emotions there. So, yeah, maybe. Yes, maybe or maybe not. I don't have a video right now, but there's already a robot which is available for 7 USD in China, which can play around with your kid and also monitor your home. 7 USD.
What is the C suite? Is it being discussed at all, or is it more of theory?
No, it does. Every C level is talking about AI. In fact, lots of implementations have been done. You might not be even knowing a bank sitting in Chennai, having a headquarter in Chennai, your interactions is not with a human but with a something like this. You might not even know. So yes, it is happening. Go ahead.
Hello. Yeah. So this race for artificial intelligence that everyone is on. So what is the target? In the sense, the objective is to make a robot like we are, because we have our own faults. Or is it to surpass us? There must be a goal, otherwise it's just a plain race.
For now, to give you a very simple answer, the objective is to improve the efficiency, to improve the productivity, to save the cost, to improve my margins, to improve quick time to market, and to improve my sales. That's the objective right now. Yeah, so I think we discussed few things of intelligence at both sides. There are many components which were mapping together, right? Emotions maybe not mapping. And that's why the robots are still not as humans, right? So we still call them robots. The day they become an act and do everything like us, they'll not be called as robots.
So, just one point.
Yeah, I'll just take one comment. Yeah, go ahead.
Right. So,
yeah, just one data point, so the human brain has 2.5 petabytes of memory, right, which is like a million gigabytes, and it's acting on that.
Correct. Which robot does not have right now, and maybe it's using cloud for that.
Okay.
That's why we have cloud. So as I said, data is the livelihood. So I'll just move to some of the technologies, again, source as in short. I've talked about a few of the technologies in indirect ways in my previous slides, but few of the important ones to also look out is, I think we've gone on through gesture recognition, right? I think that's one of the important part of the technology, how you learn gestures of a front person, and you can adopt and learn and then react according to that. Speech recognition. It's one of the important parts. That's how Siri and Cortana's and Google Now's act, and most of the other systems like that. Sensor processing, we know IoT is one of the kind of emerging and already established technology segment. Deep learning, we spot of machine learning, robotic process automations. How do you automate processes? Like you create workflows, and then how do you automate those workflows and processes? Mini bots, I think this, what I've shown is huge robots, but you have tiny bots as well, which is called as micro bots, mini bots, and so on. And my kid is fan of Big Hero 6, which is based on micro bots, right? So most of these technologies, facial recognition, you see facial recognition, Amazon launching in patent on selfie-based payment processing, right? Alibaba has something similar. This will come more and more from a security standards standpoint, access of information on your laptop, screens, and so on, right? So most of these technologies are driving artificial intelligence. So now what are the categories? So I think it's important to see, I wanted to put up this data in front of you. Somebody asked, is this really happening or is this still in theory, right? But this is actually happening. So if you see, per those categories what I listed on my previous slide, In the machine learning itself, because that's one of the core, one of the heart of artificial intelligence, which allows you to learn and adopt, you have 179 companies. And now, as I'm talking even more, slightly a few months old data, but you have more and more companies in machine learning. NLPs, again, another heart which allows you to learn that language, break up those components, and then act on those components accordingly, intelligently. So if you see the categories and the companies in those categories are as per the importance of this technology in AI, which drives larger form of artificial intelligence and robotics. If you see machine learning as well, you have more than 100 companies there, virtual personal assistants, which was I was talking from a customer standpoint, right? If you're using Hike, Hike has this human robo as well, which allows you to interact. Natasha is the name, people who like her, it's actually a robo, guys. And then computer vision, you have speech recognition, Nuance, one of the established company in speech recognition, forms an essential part. That's how again Siri, Cortana and everything works. Smart robots, Jibo, I don't know who, if you have not heard about Jibo, I advise you to go and look out at the demonstration of Jibo robots, the small robots, home robot, and it's really amazing. You should have a look at that. Gesture controls, whether fingerprints, hand movements, eye movements, and so on, all part of gesture control. There are many companies in India and also in US. Context-aware computing, so learning the context, assimilating that context, and then analyzing that context, and then recommending as per that behavior. Speech-to-speech, speech-to-text, text-to-speech, and then image, content, and so kind of processing recognition technology. So if you see, there are a variety of companies across all the categories which are delivering production-based solutions to many industries on which lots of industry have already built some solutions. So this was another report which was run by Venture Scanner to see the maturity levels. And again, on that same question, how matured they are. So if you see most of these companies and primarily on those speech recognition video, that's where because those have been going from a very long point of time as well. I mean, image processing, video recognition, speech recognition, text to speech and so on are also 10 years old, technologies as well. So they have been most matured, but now as you move, even NLPs and machine learning have also gone matured. So there are almost 7 points given on the maturity level for some of those technologies. And then all other smart robots, personal assistants, computer vision, they still fall under 4 to 5 maturity level, which is pretty huge at this particular point of time. And those are again production level solutions getting utilized by many enterprises and many companies. A quick landscape, again from Venture Scanner, whole lot of companies. I mean, this is not one or two. Every category you pick up, these are most important ones which have gone millions of fundings as well across the globe. But some of the most important ones across all of those category of technologies, and there are already listed 700 companies, but there are now more than 1,000 companies in that AI space. So I think just wanted to go through some of those categories, technologies, maturity levels, and what companies exist. I think the next important part is where do we apply this? How they are getting applied? I personally believe that there is no segment or industry or a vertical or a use case where AI cannot be applied. Anybody wants to take up that and say, no, there are a few areas where AI cannot be applied? Except there's emotional parts. Anybody who thinks that this cannot be applied?
Any area where morality exists.
So I said emotional, yeah. So moral emotions, let's keep that aside. Sorry, yeah, but you're right. So emotions, morals, obviously. But anything else? Think about from a application of technology in an industry. So any industry do you think that AI could not be suitable? Think about AI as a technology now and keep our emotions for robots aside slightly. And if you see purely AI as a technology and as a robo, from a tech point of view, any industry where you think that this technology cannot be applied? There is a robot available for $100 which can diagnose your oxygen levels. On parameters,
yeah.
On the health parameters of yours.
Yeah.
So let's say imagine you have your all devices with you, healthcare devices, and it's all connected to cloud. So there are many devices like that, right? So you have glucometers, you have blood measurements, you have thermometers, and many more, oxygen measurement and so on, right? And imagine those devices collecting all the data, putting on the cloud, and giving it to a robot. It runs all the algorithms. It goes through diagnosis of millions of records, which is how doctors learn, by the way. They are not born doctors. They learn through all of that materials which are available. And it does the same thing. So that's two robots may give you two different results, but that does not stop them to give you results. Right? Can we have a mic here? Sorry.
So in today's context, we have automated pathways. So automated pathways are what she said. You put in your results, blood and all those tests, right? So there's a software which relates it to symptoms,
right?
And then creates a chart for you,
right?
And it's all over, like your health, in terms of exercise, in terms of diet, in terms of medication, it is all automated. There's no need for a doctor. It's okay. Already there.
Say one more example. Anybody else thinks it's not applicable?
Yeah. So.
For example, can we or is there anything being done on the AI side for human mind reading?
Human mind reading?
Yeah. Because I mean, it's so dumb that, I mean, even computers that way are so dumb. I mean, I know what I want to do. Let's say, for example, I want to, you know, close a window or open something. I have to point there. I have to click. I mean, it's so dumb.
There are researches which are happening, which learns your neuro, mm-hmm. part of your brains, and learn all the signals, and actually act as a human. So there are researches happening on that.
Okay.
Many research institutes have come out with a valid proposition on that part. Reading your brains, collecting all your brain signals, right? The way you analyze your brain signals whenever you go to hospital for some other work, and it learns, adopt, react.
You have to select the mood. It can't read your mood. That's the difference.
Yeah, so mood, emotions, morals, I think that's, so, they're not reached there.
Yeah, and I'm from Sears, and we are into retail, you know, like Amazon.
Sure.
And I was doing some research on the NLP part, especially for search, because 70% of our users use search. The search. Okay, only 30% browse or go through the deals.
Yeah.
And what I noticed is even Google, and Google is the best over there, but even Google, there are quite a many use cases which it did not just understand and interpret what I wanted to say. For example, a simple thing like, you know, non-white shirt or non-red shirt. If I say red shirt, definitely yes. But when I say non-white shirt, I want to see all the shirts which are not white. But it does not have that metadata. All it knows is whether the shirt is white or red or what. But when I say non-white, what I mean? I mean, these are like very simple use cases. There are many such use cases that I found.
Yeah, so I think you're coming to a point what Larry Page has said. In fact, he goes to a point and says that, you know, they don't want anybody to even type in the query. Forget about white, non-white, red, blue, and so on. He says that Google will be involved in such a way that you will not be requiring to type even a query. You know, they learn about you and so on. But yes, lots of search engines, including Google, I'm sure Google is the fastest one to adopt NLPs and other algorithms. They're already running to a large extent. That's how you get those predictions coming there. That's how it learns and bring you notifications, Google Now and so on. But yes, all search engines are in the next evolution of bringing those technologies to make and understand those statements more clearer and adopt and react accordingly. So it's still happening, yes. And when you have an in-house search engine, so for example, online commerce, right? So they have their own way of running search engines. Some of the companies adopt Apache Lucene, something else, Elasticsearch, which have not still adopted NLPs on that, right? So then companies have to work combining NLPs and the search engines together to understand and bring those kind of things. But you're right. Yeah. Yes. Right.
What about authoring? Writing content here.
Sorry?
Right up.
Oh, okay.
Authoring, creating content, right? Writing
creating
a blog.
Content.
Something like that.
Yeah. So I think we still see applications. Yeah. But do you think AI will not be able to do that?
I think it can assimilate from multiple areas and
then it
interpret
can even,
and create
then it
the content.
Can create.
Yeah.
So it can create a text. Mm-hmm. Some form of content yes, some of contents no. Right? Okay, so entertainment is various things. Yeah, but I'm sure robots can dance. They can act. Okay. So yeah, so I think creating some form of content, yes. Maybe AI may not be applicable directly. Sure, okay. Anything else? Sure. They can still happen, correct? Yeah. Okay, so I think I'll, so far I've heard one of them, some form of content creation, but I think we fairly agree there is absolutely no vertical wherein AI cannot be applied. And now that should scare us. Yeah, so there's self-learning, this is all part of machine learning NLPs. Yeah, they do self-learn. So when they react, self-repair, oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Except it's a complete breakdown of a specific control, then they may even throw it out. They may not repair because it's not repairable. Anything which is repairable, yes, they can. Okay, they cannot create programs. Well, they can. Have you heard autocode generation technologies? Have anyone used drag and drop methods of writing a mobile application? Yeah. What is that? Generating code automatically. It's programming on its own. You add more intelligence, they'll write better code than us. I'm working with a startup in Pune, very much out of Pune, which generates code automatically based on 100 global design principles. And they're adding more and more. Think about you have 1 million global design principles. Think about the quality of code. They add all necessary security requirements from code vulnerability point of view, from API vulnerability point of view, from data security point of view, from communication security point of view, put 10 developers, they'll not do this. Right? So that may change. So that's actually happening one or other way. So I'll quickly run, since I've not got the answer, I'll take the one last one. Okay.
The results that I want. But many times those are the results, and it eliminates results which it thinks that I don't want. But that many times is actually completely counterproductive. I want the results which it thinks I don't want.
Yeah, so that's and on the maturity level of what Google is, but yes. And that's where even my company was solving that problem, which is ultra persistent, is we wanted what you want, right? What Google does not want, right? So, okay, so, but yeah, so there are maturity levels about technologies, but as we move along, they'll improve.
Yeah, but to your question where you said you know, these all things should scare you, why should it scare you? The history says that as soon as evolution happens, you know, there will be some industries or some skills which will get redundant and new skills will erupt.
Correct.
And people will have to adapt and change.
Correct.
That's the pressure we have today will exist tomorrow.
Yes. So it will open up new opportunities for us.
Fair enough.
May not necessarily replace, so you may not get scared. So on that note, I'll give an example of Siemens. So Siemens has completely automated their production line. They used to have 1,000 people. Sorry. I think I've got an example somewhere.
So will the industry take the challenge to reskill those set of people? That's the question.
Yes, that should come. Absolutely. That's the question, and I think lots of people have already started doing that. Coming back to the same example on Siemens. So Siemens has 1,000 people on their production, one of their production lines, right? What they've done is they've completely automated that production line. No human intervention is required. Everything is managed by robots. But do you think those 1,000 people were fired or 500 people were fired? How many of you think that 500 people would have been fired because of that? Right? So 1,000 people were there. Their job is now taken by robots. So what do they do? An obvious boy or boss will come up and fire them. So how many of you think that, let's start with 1,000. How many of you think all 1,000 were fired? Okay, nobody. How many of you think 500 were fired? Nobody? Pretty cool. So you're already getting into AI. How many of you think 250 people were fired? Okay, we have four guys. How many of you think 100 were fired? Okay, I'll include all of you again. How many of you think 50 people were fired? Okay, how many of you think zero were fired? Okay, some people don't have answer. So zero people were fired. And all those 1,000 people were now managing those robots, which is what exactly you said.
Exactly. We already doing it today. I mean, I'm talking about Sears. I'm also representing Sears.
Sure.
So whole idea of us is to automate all the issues which comes from the application errors.
Yeah.
So they are self-resolution, can happen, and where tickets need not come to, you know, maintenance support associates.
Yeah.
Correct? So number of tickets, if we were earlier getting 4,000 today a quarter, has come down to 100 tickets a quarter. Do you think we displaced people? No, we didn't displace people.
Okay.
We actually got more, you know, those same set of people, we got them in the development side. The money saved has to be reinvested in new technologies, right?
Yes.
If the organization fails to do that, then we have a challenge out there.
Absolutely. I think big round of applause for Sears for adopting that. No replacement, no firing of anyone whatsoever, but utilizing them, reskilling them, and opening up new opportunities for new people, right? That's another thing which comes out of that. So yes, so I think it should not scare us in a way, but it has to be seen how it goes. So I think we covered better workers, we covered some of this part, online commerce as some of the examples we already heard in Sears, right from shipping, right from logistics, from warehousing, to customer support, for automatic recommendations when you go and browse, and even talk and so on, right? So commerce is one of the areas where lots of disruption is happening by utilizing AI technologies and robotic technology in terms of warehouses and so on, right? Healthcare, we already discussed a few examples how healthcare is driving not only data collection, acting, and then reacting on that, but also precision surgeries, right? So you might have the main doctors standing on the corner of the surgery room, and there are robots who are doing all the surgery with the precision level without any human errors. Another example of robots in healthcare, and similarly many more. We already discussed some of the data collection point of view and how it becomes auto recommendation for you. I'm not sure if you have heard Varsha's presentation in the morning. You know, for example, you see screens on your windshields now, right? Which will allow you where you should go, where you should not go, what is blocking you is all driven by algorithms, right? We discovered robotic surgery and kiosk and so on, some of those applications again. Customer automation, services automation, there are there's bots who provide the services to the customers automatically using AI. In lots of intelligent automation. This was the Siemens example, as I said. All the production line, all the work was automated and was managed by those 1,000 people. And these are some of the common examples we know. Apple Siri, a great personal assistant, which allows you to do many more things, interact. If you're alone, don't worry, just talk to Siri. Facebook M, anybody using Facebook M? Anybody knows what is Facebook M? Okay, so Facebook M, all right. Can you go ahead and say?
I believe this is the lighter version of
Facebook? No, not that one. Sorry, this is the other one. Okay. So Facebook M is again bot-based chat agent, which is like you have already some of the Indian variants of that, like help chat, kuch bhi order karo, message pay, and so on. So this is an intelligent discovery in form of chat. You can say, I am looking to book a ticket on yatra.com from Pune to Mumbai, and it will do that job for you. And will give you results, will give you discovery and everything. So that's an AI-based chat engine which runs through, discovers, searches internet, get all the things in place, and you can do that. So lots of things happening on that side, launch in US. Google Now, I'm sure many of you guys indirectly use Google Now. You get the notifications, it's time to go for work, you know, it's time to go to home. That's all Google Now, right? You get the right weather, you get the maps, right where you want to go, and so on. IBM Watson, anybody knows IBM Watson? Okay, IBM Watson is an AI-based engine which has collection of millions and millions of knowledge base. It acts on that, and it has already defeated lots of you know, other engines, human engines as well, in terms of quickly responding to a query, right? So if somebody asks for a healthcare, what's the prescription for this? It could do in a fraction of a second as opposed to anybody else taking minutes and so on. Industrial robots, I think we already know, we've taken example of this. Automobile industries, manufacturings, and everywhere is getting replaced by robots. Home and retail robots, have you heard retail robots anywhere? Retail robots? So how about when you go to Croma, and there's a robot coming up and talking to you, hi ma'am, how are you? What do you want to buy today? I know that you have bought a camera last time, it was 500 rupees. Do you want to buy another one for 300 rupees? All robots, not me. Right, so that's all driving. Google driverless cars, we know about that, right? Video games, Xbox, all facial recognition, hand movements, it acts, learns, adopts. Amazon Prime Air, delivery through drones, don't need humans to deliver. Exact pin codes, can go to tier 3 cities as well. Domestic robots, you want a coffee, you don't want to get out of your chair, just order and he'll bring it for you, right? You want to monitor your home, so when you're in office, you get notifications by that monitoring which is happening, all driven by that. Military warfare, I think everybody has seen Transformer movies. Everybody, anybody has not seen Transformer? Anybody has seen a real Transformer? Okay, so there is a real Transformer which is launched by a Japanese automobile company, which is a SUV, can adopt to a Transformer this big and go back to a car. So yeah, I mean, military is heading towards that. Weather predictions. Google does weather, now does weather predictions, weather.com, they does lots of AI algorithms run on top of that, right? Code programmers, I already given an example to the question asked. Code programmers, education, there are many robots in US, in Japan, wherein the learning is happening through robots. In fact, robots are even acting as telematics, as a teacher remotely. It's a robot which is standing in front of all of you and talking to you and giving you learn, and the picture of teacher coming in the robot's face. It's all telematics. Healthcare, we already discussed, precision surgeries, symptoms, prescriptions. So I think those are fairly what I've covered. There are many other which we, as we have anyway agreed, there is nothing which is left. But these are all what is happening today in production environments and all life, and saving cost, improving margins, you know, allowing humans lagged in technology innovations most of the times, but I think AI is a limitless, you know, ecosystem of imagination. It allows any country, any individual, any company, any enterprise, any startup to innovate. I think this is the next big opportunity for every one of you sitting here to think, imagine, and create AI, right? Not to scare anybody, but to do good things, what I've just talked about. And as Steve Jobs has always said, stay hungry, stay foolish. AI allows you to do that. It allows you to be always hungry of data. It allows you to be hungry of think, innovate, what else I can do? How can I automate this bottle? How can I automate this table? How can I make table talking to me? How can I make bottle talking to me? And so on, right? You never know. It's limitless imaginations. So it allows you to be change maker. Hence, you can innovate. You know, you can think, you can imagine, and you can be a change maker. So everybody has an opportunity to be a change maker through AI and robotics. So coming back to the point, right? We're saying which one is better, humans, superhumans, robots, AI. So do we think that there's a war? Are we starting a war? Anybody thinks now that we are starting a war? We still think that we are starting a war? Yes, okay. There's one person who says we'll start war. Maybe yes, we don't know. It all depends upon how do we create. It's our imagination, right? So if our imagination lands to a war, it will land to a war.
Yeah, Terminator.
But that's where the ethics comes out. So when you design an AI-based robot, what do you have to do? You have to put people first. If you don't put people first, you lead to a war. Absolutely, you lead to a war. But if you put people first, you put ethics first, you'll not end up where we might end up. So, end of the day, who do we like more, humans or robots? Okay, so we are putting people first. It's a good start. So this was a small research which was done. How people perceive about AI, how people perceive it's a blessing or a curse. So there's some interesting things which has come around. Yeah, majority of them says mistrustful. It might be if you do not program it well, obviously it will go into something else. Powerless, yes, it is powerless in a way right now, because we are designing them and we're not making them so intelligent, but the race for intelligence will not stop. Optimistic, so many people are optimistic what it can do, what good it can do for us. Skeptical, 32% largely don't know what will happen. We're skeptical about that. And there, but if you see, there's still 18% who still says accepting, and 20% who still says inspired, excited, and so on. So there is still a mix and match response. By the way, it's a global survey run by this company, Satishia, or the marketing research company globally. And interesting results have come out. So what we'll do is, I think we are almost bang on time. We just want to do a very small workshop. Every one of you has notepads with you, right? What do I want is, you pick up any vertical you like. It may be same vertical what you're working on. And just write two use cases of how AI can improve your business, can reduce your cost, can increase your margins, can allow humans to do better job as opposed to what they're doing right now, right? So I want two use cases in a vertical you choose and pick, which can help on those areas. So write your vertical, what you want to address, and then just write 2 points. Very simple case, and we're gonna just share those ideas. And the whole idea is to innovate. Imagine, go beyond what I've talked about, and put up all your brains what you can, which could be really innovative in nature. Okay, so we'll give around 5 minutes, right? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Just write the vertical name and 2 use cases, what you think can innovate and improve things where they stand currently. And you don't know, Sears may even hire you. Done, what I want is on a table, have a quick discussion and choose 3 important points out of that. it could be a combination of verticals, one vertical or whatever. And then we'll have each person on the table just to speak out what do you think about that, right? Okay. So every table, just make friends along if you have not till now. We're still humans. If you think all the points are important, please feel free. There is no hard and fast rule to really shrink out.
So this was on AI and robotics as a session. We're running a small workshop. We have to pick up a vertical and think within that vertical how AI can help. So if you, let's say, pick up warehouse mein how robots can help. Right, so we have to run out two use cases. Pick up any vertical. So you can two combine.
Just note down final points on one of the notepads so that, you know, one of the person can speak it out. So we'll give maybe another 5 minutes to consolidate some of the points, verticals. And feel free, I said, if it's more than one vertical, it's okay. 4 or 5 points, it's okay. Yeah, let me do that. Go ahead.
As Arjun, the vertical is financial services.
Okay.
I built a portal, personal finance portal for salary.
Guys, everyone, if you can listen to what he's saying, this may help you if you're in that industry.
So, we're hearing about robo-advisors and things like that in the financial industry, so financial services industry. So I'm building a personal finance portal for salaried professionals. Now, typically how the portfolio is designed is static as of today. So you have your personal condition as of today, you have a goal and there's a gap. To reach that gap, they'll suggest some investment portfolio, which the portal does as of now.
Automatically.
But it would be good if using artificial intelligence, if you have thousands and thousands of customers, you can learn from what they've done and how they've achieved their goal and which portfolios work better.
Absolutely.
Under different circumstances.
Absolutely.
And then if you type in a goal and it says, okay, based on your goal, this portfolio has a 95% chance of success rate that you'll achieve your goal within 5 years based on analyzing data of 100,000 people who
all
are
automated.
Already registered on this
all
site.
Automated.
And everything is automated. There's no human intervention. So it's unbiased, first of all, because it's based on an algorithm. And it's based on a lot of data.
Sure.
So you may be great fund manager, but eventually you can also make mistakes. This is supporting.
I'll give you my personal experience. There was a wealth advisor who came to me after I sold my company, and she was like, "Sir, we can do this for you, and we can generate 20% returns for you." And I asked a very simple question: can you give me a data of your previous customers where you achieved 20% returns? There's absolutely no answer. And she never called me back. So you solved the problem. Big applause for him. That's it? Just one point? Okay.
Right. There's one more, from the media industry, typically because you talked about robots. So what happens is in the media industry, and I represent, I was on a panel for a media company in Pune. So they have a very large manufacturing setup and it's all time bound. One of the things that they always worry about is the electricity consumption.
Sure.
And on a daily basis, typically you get to know only at the end of the month, you know, how much was your electricity spent. So you cannot really take any corrective actions. So if you have a robot which is actually, because these days these meters are with those SIM cards. What you need to do is you need to go to the vicinity of that and then take the reading. So it may not be possible for a human to, kind of diligently go to those 100 meters located at different places. But if you have a robot which will get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, take the reading, get the whole thing on the cloud. So that's some of the business case that we talked.
Very good example. Big applause. We don't have that right now.
And maybe use IoT.
And use IoT, yes. Okay, we'll start with that table. You have collected all the points. Okay, so who is the guy who is going to speak on behalf of table? Okay, go ahead. Can you just pass on the mic, please?
Basically, the domain is environment. You can say agriculture. Basically, my core background is from the agriculture. So can we use AI in terms of, you know, global warming, and we can, you know, save the plants, or we can, you know, develop any kind of, you know, robot which we can plant the trees and, you know, nurture them for years and years, so that we can reduce the global warming as well as, you know, we can reduce the water consumption, all those things.
Climate control powered by AI?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I am currently working on advertising network for public displays. So the problem we have is each video that has been submitted to our network has to be manually checked for the content and then approved. So with machine learning, image processing, we can improve this process and automate it, completely automate it, so that the admin part is removed and our content will be automatically approved.
Correct. Content authorizing, we discussed, all automated, powered by AI. Okay, very nice example. Can you pass on the mic to other table?
One of the examples we thought of in financial services industry, fraud detection can be one of the ways.
Sure. Fraud detection, risk assessments, and so on in the financial service industry is very critical, which is already happening in a way. If you know company Palantir, right, you should follow the company. It does exactly what you're saying, all powered by AI.
We are into agriculture, and one of the things that we could use AI is basically to build, labor is very expensive, getting very expensive there as well. So harvesting, like picking the right fruit to pick, whether it's ready to harvest, not ready to harvest, like a green tomato versus a red tomato and those kinds of things. So that could basically save a lot of labor and help in food production.
Yes, we won't see a human pulling a bullock cart, putting his sweat on the ground, right? It's a good example. So he's just finishing up, and then I'll come to this row.
I actually do physics-based modeling for design optimizations of equipments like automobile, aerospace, process, and other industries.
Okay.
So I do physics-based simulation, so it is some way of actually predicting itself. It is a predictive software. But I can combine it with, let's say, experimental data and other intelligence to make my predictions better and also faster. I don't have to do all the physics simulation. I can combine it with data and fill the gaps only with physics, then I can do it much faster.
Right.
Plus, there are processes and for which even today physics is not understood at all. Since they are so random that we cannot express it mathematically very well. So there also, I think, data which we can analyze in a way that, in a non-deterministic way, which can capture the essence of randomness and patterns without forcing it into any kind of, you know,
sure,
mathematical straitjacket, let's say.
Okay.
There also it can be very useful.
All right, absolutely.
I'm a second year engineering student. I'm
okay.
In electronics and telecommunication.
So from which AI, college?
Pune Institute of Computer Technology.
Okay, all right.
So AI is my field, and I've thought of many ideas in it previously. One of them is we do not have
don't
any.
Don't share your startup idea if you're sharing, starting that. I'm just kidding. I'm just saying if you are going to share something, what are you going to start? Don't share that. People will snatch it away.
Okay. So one solution you already mentioned, like prosthetic arms and limbs.
Okay.
Integrating them with your brain and then using it for paralysis especially.
Okay. All right.
And there were many ideas, but you stopped me. You cautioned me.
No, I was just kidding. So feel free to share.
I took it seriously.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
No, thank you. Can we pass on to the next table, please, there? Over here. I think we're done there. Yeah.
So this one is the manufacturing space. Typically, when you're doing prototyping, you go through a set of rapid prototyping, you go through a set of processes. So typically you have a design, you want to see what different models can be done. Possibly use artificial intelligence or even robots to get that done almost immediately. So that you can then sort of pick it up and take it for production.
Okay, very cool.
The other was for car servicing.
Okay.
I just put my car in the garage and it detects all the diagnostics and senses what all needs to be done.
Yes.
Repairs my car and delivers it to me.
In your own garage?
No, I don't. But I have to go to the garage.
Oh, very great idea. A big applause for him.
Yeah, hi, this is Rahul. I think I have one idea again related to agriculture domain. So basically, currently observing current demand and supply of agriculture goods and predicting the future demands, and based on that, basically managing the produce. So the rates of agriculture produce are always controlled and in a good manner.
Okay.
Hi, this is Abhijit and I'm from healthcare industry. We have this concept of population health wherein the patient's information and data is captured in one single repository. That is in place, but the areas where it is used is quite minimal. So with the introduction of AI, once the patient comes to hospital, we can capture that data, compare it with other patient's data, assign the correct and appropriate doctor or physician to that patient directly to avoid time delays. And we can also find out the any kind of impacts based on the patient's symptoms with that repository data.
Okay, very cool. So I'll hand over the mic to the table. So yeah, you go.
I have a couple of things in the CSR area, no vertical or this thing.
Sure.
Basically, it's saying that one is poverty alleviation. So basically, pick the pockets of the rich and give it to the poor, that sort of thing. Then one is basically we need some corruption prevention for politicians.
Okay.
So studying whatever mechanism, how they sort of.
Okay. And why don't somebody tweet about this so it reaches our Prime Minister?
And one is this converting the sea water to drinkable water.
Okay.
Because sea water is available in plenty, but still people don't have water.
Yes.
So if some...
Water everywhere, not a drop to drink.
That is the same. So these three things I thought...
Thank you.
Not belonging in any vertical.
This again related to retail e-commerce domain. And we are already doing this to a large extent. So it's like predicting next purchase of a customer. So based on a lot of data.
Yeah.
And then we can use this information to personalize the offer. I mean, it's not like a site-wide 20% off or a 10% off, but you know, every customer will get his own personalized offer. So we are doing that up to a large extent. So for example, a customer is at point of sale. By the time the bill is ready or printed, the server is able to get back and print a personalized offer on his receipt or her receipt.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's one.
So I had some examples which already relate to the others which have been mentioned. The one which I would like to mention is for quite some time we've been talking about robots being non-emotional, and I chose an example where we can use that as an advantage. Typically, I come from the oil and gas industry, and it's extremely important to be HSE compliant, and the safety parameters have to be met and checked very regularly on the offshore oil rigs. And many times when it's humans, then say, everything's working,
it is fine.
But when really there's an emergency situation, then there are two, three things which break and they're not really up to the mark that causes the disaster. So I think if that kind of a job is really given to a robot to do it with all the parameters configured, then I think there will be a more trusted checklist being done.
Sure. Very nice example. robots in oil and gas manufacturing industry. Okay.
Okay, I have chosen a scenario in the manufacturing sector where we can think of machines and let's say an assembly line, and it has a lot of machinery. And we all know that if any machinery breaks down and the production line stops, then there is that downtime is very costly. So then if there can be machines which can already do their own health check, and then when, for example, and there is a certain threshold which is breached, then they can start doing a little self-healing also. For example, things like their the oil level is low in a particular machinery, then they sort of have it replenished again. Sure. So I think that is one way that automation can help.
Okay.
I think in another scenario also, I think where I was reading somewhere, I think, that for example, there's an aircraft in the air, and then if the and a self health check is done while it is in the air. So already once it lands, then the technicians on the floor already know what needs to be done. So it saves a lot of time.
Sure. Yeah. All right. Cool.
Based on your CSR example, you know, this one thought just on the fly I came was on town planning. You know, town planning can be, a lot may can be automated, and based on the demand, how it comes on a Pune city. So the more the population increases, the more, you know, plans getting submitted for high rise, that automates, you know, to create the right infrastructure.
Yeah.
Correct. And drive.
Smart cities.
Smart cities.
Yeah.
Correct.
Absolutely.
No. Correct. So that's one. So also eliminating a lot of corruption in the process. Okay. So. Thank you for
setting the context.
We all from this retail industry, so there are a couple of examples. What we discussed was, one, we are looking at something on inventory movement based on the demand and supply, correct? So we know where the stock lies, we know where the demand's coming in, and decision needs to be automated to move that inventory from one location if you can't source it on time. So that's one of the area we want to look at. Second area we want to look at is packet sorting at warehouse. You know, right product gets delivered to the right products, and robots can pick up from the right shelf.
Yes.
And you know, even we've seen at Sears warehouse back at US, this is such a large warehouse. So you need a route optimization also to pick up, you know, which route to pick up which product first, pick the product from that aisle, and make sure it goes to the right customer package and delivered. So that's the second area of automations we want to really look at. And third, what we want to look at is, you know, prediction of customers on a particular stores, right? We know a lot of cities publish, you know, what are the events happening locally. We also know what kind of weather, you know, changes are happening. Summer's coming early, winter's going late. So demands will prop up, and we need to ensure inventories are there. Thus, we expect if inventory is automated, then we expect the customers also footfall on those areas. So it does a prediction for us. You can expect these customers more for us. So that kind of, you know, thought process we had.
Any vendors, by the way, listening to him? He's from Sears.
And the last one era is on theming discussion. I mean, a lot of people want to plan their birthday party anniversaries, right? And it is a lot of pain for people to, you know, search website, look at different themes, what happening, you know, look at, go to restaurant, five restaurants, look at menus, options, and, you know, confuse themselves. If there is automated system, you say, I have an anniversary, it may throw up five options.
Yeah.
It may select the, you know, based on a budget, may select, you know, right restaurant near to your area and recommend and give you solutions.
Absolutely. Yeah. Big applause for very nice use case. Next table. So I think we're running short of time, so we'll just take one point from last four tables. Okay, sorry for that.
Two small points. One was continuing with the CRM. I think that's a good inspiration. So I would say traffic management and traffic policing in, to make a smart city.
Okay.
And in my vertical, I'm a chartered accountant who's into consulting. I would say the biggest area is customer response, customer care, because there are calls which come which every time might not go to a partner level person. And these could be basic queries which can be attended. Also reminders and all, you know, so that CRM kind of a...
Sure. Okay. No. So we'll just pass on to other table, I'm sorry. Just trust 5 minutes to go.
My idea was related to parking spaces, like managing parking spaces. You can have automatic valets that can, you can leave your car and they'll manage it properly.
Yeah, so it's like combination of human-driven and self-driving cars.
Yeah, I mean, you can leave it in an area and they'll manage.
And they'll manage, find out, figure out, and park it out. Yeah, very great. Yeah, over here.
Yeah, so we can use AI to learn behavior of the person. So that this has two advantages. One is parents can do a research on how the child is posting online.
Okay.
And understand if he's going on the wrong path or something.
Yeah.
And the second thing is to stop the terrorist attacks, what is happening.
Yeah,
in the,
yeah, absolutely.
So that, that is
the great. So we'll just pass on to the last table there. Back.
And just adding to it, it can also be used if you know a behavioral pattern of a particular person. Like how people do the psychometric analysis, you can also get to hire good people.
Yeah.
You know what they comply with the vision of the company.
Yes. Hiring, job industry, yeah, there's lots of scope of automation. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Agree. So I think a big applause for that. And a job industry is one thing which can automate and get right jobs for you and for the company. So the list, last table.
Hi, I'm an investment banker. I raise private equity funds.
I'm sorry for my comments if I'm talking about that.
And the verticals that I like to work with is surgical robotics companies. And the one which has really helped a lot is where, you know, there's the robot which goes inside and the image tells the doctor. It shows the cancer cells in a different color altogether. So the cancer cells, they light up and they are shown as fluorescent. So normally when a doctor opens up a patient and everything looks the same, the cancer cells don't look any different from the
yeah.
normal cells.
Yeah.
So this has actually, it helps the doctor take out just the cancer cells and leave the rest of the patient pretty intact.
Precision
and since
surgery.
This is done in a laparoscopic manner, there's no wound and it helps heal so much faster.
Absolutely.
So within 3 days, the patient is out.
Absolutely. Thank you for that. So I think, we have one more. Okay.
So with the globalization, we have the nuclear families and parents are getting old and they are staying alone in houses. So can we have robots to help them at least with their physical needs? Helping them take to the washrooms or helping them with their regular activities. That can
yeah,
help.
So you get rid of maids. Every morning your wife does not shout out, maid nahi aayi. Okay, so I think, thank you all of you. Okay, you have one more point, let's go.
Yeah, I have heard all of all people's views regarding developments. Please take the IPR. Intellectual
IPR?
Property rights. Please
okay.
ensure that you will have your IPR.
Yes, yes, very good point. Except we have to wait what government is trying to do and make software patents irrelevant. So that is to be seen, but yes, very good point. As I said, there is an opportunity to innovate, be hungry, be foolish, be a change maker, and product your ideas. Please file patents, and you have lots of scope of patent filing in this space. Unimaginable, limitless. So I hope all of you had fun. I thank you very much to be so engaging. It made my job much more easier. Thank you for co-hosting this presentation with me because lots of comments came around from all of you. And I hope that it helped you. I hope that it helped other people to understand ideas and to improve your business margins. Before I end, before you think automation, before you think robotics, before you think artificial intelligence, what do you have to think? Humans. Think people first. All right. Thank you and have a wonderful day. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. I hope you all enjoyed the session. We'll be getting the ballroom together. So you can just have your tea break and come back. Thank you.